Man, I want to, man, if you just sit tight for a little bit, let me lay out. My wife told you about the classes, the Tabernacle of Moses, right, on Wednesday nights. I think it's the 26th, I think it is.
Yeah.
Wednesday the 26th of this month, we're going to start going through the Tabernacle of Moses by Kevin Connor. If you don't have the book, man, go on Amazon and get you a book. The Lord is bringing me back to where it all began 17 years ago. How, you know, the Lord began to reveal and show me all the things that's actually hidden in His Word. And we're going to get into some of them today. Today, I'm going to be talking about the different arcs that's in the Bible. You know, Noah's Ark, Moses, the Ark of Moses, Moses' little ark. And then the Ark of the Covenant. And then Christ the Ark. So, and this picture and this pattern that God has given us, that He's laid out so we can learn. I've been doing a teaching right now on what God had said, build it according to the pattern. There's a pattern in the Old Covenant that God has showed us how the New Covenant, the New Testament church is supposed to be. And if we build it according to His pattern, it's almost like with the Field of Dreams. You know, if you build it, they will come. And I'm like, Lord, where are you at? But I just want to, you know, it's good to see you guys. I want to also, you know, invite and thank you guys for tuning in on Facebook. This is our first go around. You're definitely in for a ride. And don't forget, the 26th of April on Wednesday nights, we're going to be going through this book. I'm telling you, you'll see the Word of God in a totally different perspective. We'll be using it as a guideline as we go through the Word, but it's going to begin to open up the mysteries, the hidden things of God, and it really brings you into learning. Jesus was a Jew. Yeshua was His name. Yeshua, His name means salvation. God gave the Word to the Jewish people. All the disciples were Jews. You know, the customs of the Jews is what unlocks the mysteries of the Bible, things that have been hidden. So when you know it, and you see it, and you understand what names mean, and numbers, and colors, and just little sayings that Jesus said, man, you think you have an understanding of it, but you really don't. Unless you actually go study the customs of the people, whether it's in Asia or any other place. You know, a martial artist, they can only go so far here, and if they want to go further, they actually will go to China or Japan or whatever it is to learn from the grandmasters, because they want to go deeper. Well, over here in the West, you know, we've been taught from a Western perspective, you know, and if you really want to have a better understanding, you know, of what the Word is and who He is and what He's about and, you know, what's coming, it's all in the beginning of the book. That which was is that which shall be, and there's no new thing under the sun. You know, God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He moves in a circle and a cycle. You're going to see that every arc that we're going to talk about today is saying the same thing all the way till Christ comes. And He is the fulfillment of it. So you guys ready? Man. I want to, I've been ministering on, the Lord told me, build it according to the pattern that, you know, that I showed you. He had told Moses and David when they was building the temples, you know, and the tabernacle and the temple. And when God told Noah to build the ark, you know, He didn't leave nothing up to Noah. He didn't leave not one detail to Noah on how to build this ark. He didn't leave one detail to Moses on how to build the tabernacle. It was divinely given by God's word and said, listen, this is the way I want you to build it. This is how big I want you to build it. And He didn't leave nothing out. He didn't leave nothing for Moses to say, okay, like we come in here and we set up this building right here, you know, and some of us say, oh, we want this color carpet or we want this over here and that over that, you know, and that's fine. But when God was laying out the pattern for the church, man, He gave it exactly the way it's supposed to be. I mean, if you think about it, over here in the West, everything that you walk around and everything you do in the church is focused around a tabernacle and a temple. Why do they call this an altar up here? Why do we have a praise and worship team, ministry, worshiping up here? This is all Old Covenant. We learned from it. This was our example, so we know how to come to the Father and worship Him. Why do we tell people repent and be baptized for remission of sins? That's in the Old Covenant. It's in the New Testament too. But the disciples and the apostles, what were they doing? They were repeating the Old Covenant. It ain't an Old Testament. The Testament still stands today. Not one jot or tittle will pass away. The only thing that's been done away in the Old Covenant is the sacrificial system. That's it. It's done. Everything else still stands. So as we go into this, you know, it's going to be really good. So let's pray. Father, Lord, You're absolutely amazing. Your Word, Father, is what's quick and powerful.
Yes, it is.
And sharper than any two-edged sword. Lord, if we don't have the Word of God in us, Father, then we're not quick and powerful. The Word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword. And that's why, Father, You say it's the sword of the Spirit. It's what the Spirit uses when the Word is inside of us, Father. The Spirit brings that Word to our remembrance. Just like You told the disciples, don't worry about what you're going to say, for the Spirit is going to bring it all back to your remembrance, all that I've spoken to you the past 3.5 years. You see, Christ, He was the Word made flesh. He was pouring the Word of God into His disciples, these disciplined learners. That's why the Lord said, go forth and make disciples. He was pouring His Word inside of them. And though they didn't understand everything, He said, look, when everything is all done and said, you're going to understand. And then you're going to have power. And that power and that authority comes from His Word. You need the Word of God in you. One thing here at this church, I push more than anything, is God's Word. And I tell people every single week, read your Word. Spend time in your Word. Get with Jesus. Get face to face with Him. Because that's what the Word of God is. It's the bread. And do you know that we're living in a time that the Bible says that the children of Israel on the sixth day, day six, they picked up double the manna. You know what that means? The time that we're living in right now, we're in the 6,000 year, almost at the end of it. This is the time, this is when we're picking up a double portion of what they had back then. God is pouring out His Word, a double portion. We have both the Old Covenant and the New Covenant. Here, the Lord gave me this. Check this out. Oh, thank You, Father. It's going to be a good teaching. So just stick with me. It's called The Riches of Redemption. I wrote this down. The Lord gave me this. I put it in my Bible. No matter how you cut the Word of God, it bleeds Jesus. Man. Because that's all I want. It's Him. You can cut it into just the Torah, which is the first 5 books of Moses. You can cut it into the Psalms and the Prophets. You can cut it into the Old Covenant and the New Covenant. But the fact of the matter is, still today, it bleeds Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Amen.
I don't care how you cut it. It's all about Him. And the Spirit has come to reveal Him. Not me, not any other pastor. The Spirit has come to bear witness to who Jesus Christ is.
Amen.
For He shall not speak of Himself, but He, the Holy Spirit, God's Spirit, Jesus said, will testify of me. And He will show you things to come.
Amen.
And if you go in the Old Covenant and the first 39 books of the Bible, every story, every jot, every tittle, the Spirit will show you it bleeds Jesus. You see, salvation can't come without the shedding of blood. So every story in there is a scarlet thread.
Oh, hallelujah.
Yeah. that brings you straight to the cross. There was a blood trail from Egypt. 40 years in a wilderness in the shape of a cross, sacrificing, a blood trail from Egypt to Sinai, from Sinai to the Jordan, from the Jordan to the Temple Mount. If you follow that blood trail, it will lead you to Jesus. And Jesus will take you to his Father. Realize and understand how important it is for you to know the Word. Because you're going to need it in the end. You understand me? You're going to need the Word of God in you in the end. Because if you don't have it in you, you're going to be shaken and your tree is going to fall down. Get to know Him now. My pastor told me, you know, almost in 1996, Papa Hickman said, you better know him heart to heart before you meet him face to face. I know him. And it grieves me in my spirit that people don't have a passion for him. Do you realize the greatest commandment of all is to love the Lord God with all of your heart, with all of your mind, with all of your soul and all of your strength. That is the greatest commandment. Do you realize if you don't love him like that, he is second in your life and you are sitting on your own throne? Do you realize that? Why is the second law of Moses, just as defined as the first, as just as important to love your neighbor as yourself? You know why? Because God loves people. He died for people. He died and bled for you and me. And the only thing that you could give back to him is others. Right. We have been given the ministry of reconciliation. You have to know your word. You have to study the word to show yourself approved, not unto a man. I'm not here to impress you with the word of God. To show yourself approved unto the Father.
Amen.
And be ready to give an answer to anyone that asks you a question about Jesus Christ. No word, no power. The Holy Spirit bears witness to the testimony of Jesus Christ. You think the power of the Holy Spirit is just some kind of thing that's come in you that is giving you some Superman power? Is that what you think it is? The Holy Spirit only moves on the Word of God. Amen. That's Bible. And there's a lot of other things He does. There's the gifts He gives us so we can help one another. You have to come into the holy place. You see, the process that I've been showing you guys is from the altar, that brazen altar, and we went through that. My ministry is to bring you into the throne room. I don't want you just passing by. I want you to come in and meet my dad. Don't stop outside. That's where everybody stops outside. They don't come into the door. Oh yeah, I passed by your house. Did you come in? You know my dad? You met my dad? Oh yeah, I know. Yeah, I know your dad. Did you meet him? No, I never met him, but I know him. I know Joseph's dad. No, you don't. You haven't spent time with him.
Amen.
You have no idea. You think you do. In fact, you say you know my dad. And my dad don't even know who you are. He's never met you. You know, when I was in Poplarville, we had the church in Poplarville. I was pumping gas. And this guy pulled up beside me in the car and got out. And he seen all the writing on the truck. And he said, "Oh, you the one that's got that thrift store up there?" I said, "Yeah." You know, the thrift store? And I said, "Yeah." He said, "Yeah, I know the pastor over there. And that's where I go to church. I go to the Citadel church." He was talking to the pastor of the Citadel church. I'm pumping gas. I'm like, and I said, "Really?" He said, "Oh, yeah." He said, "That's where I go to church. I go to the Citadel church." I said, "Brother, I'm the pastor. I don't know you." He didn't know what to say. "My sister goes there. My auntie," is what he said. I said, "Who's your auntie?" And he told me her name, and she did go there. But you see, he said that's where he went. He said, how many other people did he tell he belonged to the Citadel Church, and I never saw him there? He's proclaiming to know me and never met me. And I have no idea who he is. But yet he's telling people he goes to the Citadel Church. You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I'm trying to get you to come in. Don't stop at the door. Repentance and baptism. Once you do that, you're standing at the door. Come into the house and get to know him. We've done went through the altar and the laver. And the reason we've been doing this is because God said, build the church, build it according to the pattern I showed you. And I've been telling you guys, these pieces need to be inside of you because you are the tabernacle of the living God.
Yes.
He lives inside of you now. The altar and the laver, you have to walk in it. Repentance and baptism. You have to gird about your loins, the door, the belt, the truth. You have to know what the lampstand is, the showbread table and the altar of incense. We went through all this. If you don't know what that is, you guys out there on Facebook, if you don't know what it is, and you can make it, man, Wednesday nights on the 26th, if you really want more of Jesus, the 26th. In fact, 26 is the number of Yahweh. So if you want more of Yahweh, if you want more of God, man, come on the 26th of this month, because we're going to get into some amazing things. Let's get started. The Lord had, about probably 3 weeks ago, the Lord started talking to me. And he kept saying, "Ark, the Ark, the Ark." And I'm like, "What do you mean? I mean, Lord, what's up with the Ark of the Covenant? You keep telling me the Ark, the Ark." And all of a sudden, you know, I just got a desire to go look for the Ark of the Covenant. Well, the Lord, you know, was also bringing up the number 17. 17 is the number of resurrection. Christ was raised up on the 17th day. The Noah's Ark was lifted up on the second month, the 17th day. These are the things that is like absolutely amazing in the Word. But I'm like, "Lord, what are you trying to tell me with the Ark?" You know, 17, 17. Well, the Lord brought me back 17 years ago where it all began. And that's what's happening right now. God is doing something, man, just an amazing thing in His church right now. So anyway, he kept telling me the Ark, the Ark, the Ark. So, you know, I went, and I know that Ron Wyatt had found the Ark of the Covenant. The Ark of the Covenant. It's a covenant that was made with man. But man, and I looked at it, and I seen it before, and I'm like, "Man, Lord, when did he find it? When did he find it?" I was looking all over when he found it, and it was, you know, he found it in 1982. Really found it. I mean, it's proof. He found the Ark of the Covenant. It's still hidden away for a time, but he found the Ark. But I'm like, you know, he wouldn't leave me alone. The Ark, the Ark. And I'm like, "Lord, what?" And I'm like, "Man, I wonder when he found it." And then I was looking at one of his videos. He's standing in a cave. I looked on Wiki, all this kind of stuff. And the Lord was pressing on me to look even deeper. And here Ron White standing in the cave, and he says, I found the ark January the 6th, 1982. January the 6th.
It's your birthday.
It's my birthday. I was like, what? After all of these years of the ark, and I'm not special, God was just trying to show me something. After all of these years, the ark being hidden away from 586 BC. Now you think about this. The ark has been hidden away for now about 2,500 years. And here it is in 1982, Ron Wyatt finds the Ark of the Covenant. And if you want to look into it, you could check it out. But the Lord was speaking to me about the ark, the ark, the ark. So this is what it's about today. Let me tell you a little bit about the ark and what it is. Now ready? I'm going to lay some groundwork for you guys. Thank you, Father. What I had told you guys the last time I had spoke, I had walked you through and showed you the outer courts, the inner courts, and the Holy of Holies. And I told you that there was a representation of this that we could see on the earth. And I showed you how when Jesus was in, you know, having the Passover meal, well, it was actually the meal that was right before the Passover, that was explaining who he was. They was in the holy place. It was a representation of the holy place here on earth. And then after that, he told them to go wait till they be endued with power, not, you know, after he showed himself 40 days. And then they went in the upper room. There's a representation of the outer courts, the inner courts, which is the holy place where you have the lampstand, the showbread table, and the altar of incense, was where Christ was communing with his disciples and they were eating the bread. That's the holy place. He's the light of the world. They're eating the bread. He's about to make a sacrifice at the altar of incense. So in the holy place, not the most holy, in the holy place, we could see a picture of what's happening right here on earth, right? So Christ has got his disciples, 12 disciples, in the holy place. He's the lampstand. He's the bread from heaven. He's explaining all that. He's about to make a sacrifice, die, that's going to be a pleasing savor unto the Lord. That's in this holy place. There's also a representation of the most holy place and what it is. And that's where I'm going to take you now. You ready? Let's go. The message today is called a divine habitation. A divine habitation. And the Lord said, build it according to the pattern that I showed you. Because if Noah wouldn't have built it just like God said, then nothing would have been preserved in it. If he would have left out any detail, he gave them the length, the breadth, the width, the height of it. How many levels, a door, a window, what it's supposed to be made out of. He gave him everything he needed. Why? Because it's a picture of Jesus Christ. That's why. Listen to this. In the Old Covenant, God has set forth revelation of divine truth in three distinct arcs. Noah's ark. Moses had an ark, a little basket, a weaved basket that he was placed in with a lid, pitch within and without. And the Ark of the Covenant. That was the three distinct arcs. You're going to see they're all the same in the Old Covenant. In the Old Covenant, God set forth revelation of divine truth in three distinct arcs. Each one of these arcs carries with it the thought of preservation. Noah's Ark in Genesis 6 through Genesis 9 and in 1 Peter 3 verse 20. In the ark speaks of preservation from judgment. Here we see the judgment of God upon man and Noah and his family along with the clean and unclean animals. animals being preserved from destruction if they was inside of the ark, if they came in through the door. When God told Noah to build this ship, this boat, it didn't look like a boat with a turned up hull. It was just square. And I'm going to show you that. I'm going to give you the word for it. It had three levels in it. Why? Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. It was preserved. It was made of acacia or shittim wood, which speaks of incorruption. That was Christ. His body didn't see corruption. There was only one door in. Jesus said, I'm the only way, right? I'm the door in John 10:9. There was three levels inside of one ark. Three levels. The Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Noah's name means rest. Hebrews 4, it says that we're to strive to enter into that rest, and that rest is Jesus. Noah was a picture of Jesus Christ. Right? Eight people were saved. Why? Eight is a number of new beginnings. God is going to destroy the earth. You guys know it, but those guys out there don't. The Bible says that Noah was to take in seven of every clean animal by pairs, and two of every unclean animal by pairs was to come in, both male and female, in the ark. Why? Why clean and unclean animals? What do they represent? It represents the Jews, the clean, and the unclean, the Gentiles. Remember Peter? The Lord told Peter, a sheet was let down from heaven. He's seen all kind of unclean animals on the sheet. And God said, kill Peter and eat. No, Lord, nothing unclean has never touched these lips. Three times. Why three? Because three is the number of witnesses. Let everything be established by two or three witnesses. And this is when actually, what's his name? To the centurion's house.
Cornelius.
Cornelius, thank you, brother. He was going to Cornelius' house. Cornelius was a Gentile. And God told Peter, look, I'm sending you to the Gentiles. The sheet that came down was unclean animals. God was letting Peter know that I'm engrafting in the unclean animals, the Gentiles. So the clean and the unclean are being grafted in through Jesus Christ, who's the door. Pretty amazing stuff, huh? The Bible says it was pitch within and without. The word pitch there, look it up, Hebrew Strong's, it's the word kafar, which means to atone, a smear with blood. This ark, Noah's ark, Noah's name means rest. Christ is our ark. He is our preservation. The Bible says his body didn't see decay. That's why it was made of shittim wood. Wood speaks of humanity. I see men as trees walking. Unless you bear fruit, you'll be cut down and thrown into the fire. All through the word. Two sticks are joined together. The stick of Joseph and Judas, Joseph and Judah become one stick, humanity, man. Aaron's rod that budded brought forth an almond fruit. It was dead, but it raised again and brought forth fruit. Humanity, man, wood. You with me? The ark. Listen, if you don't come in, you're not saved. You have to know. You have to come in. You have to follow the word. It's a pattern for you and me. Do you know that right now today, some people think, oh, you're talking about that Old Testament stuff. Listen to me. It's not an Old Testament. It's an old covenant that bleeds Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
And if you don't know it, there's got to be a witness. Jesus Christ himself said, if I witnessed of myself, if I just bore witness of myself, my word wouldn't mean anything. But my Father, the old covenant, testifies of me.
Right.
Do you realize that all the apostles and everyone after Christ, the Bible wasn't compiled to around 160. So when they started ministering the word, what scriptures did they use? Study to show yourself approved unto God.
Yeah.
Oh, covenant. Jesus said, what he said in John chapter 5, you search the scriptures and in them you think you have life. But those scriptures testify of me. Peter said in 1 Peter, he said, if any man speak, let him speak as of the oracles of God. What was that? The old covenant. In Hebrews chapter 10, Jesus said, which is a repeat from Psalms, do you realize that the new covenant that's written, they're taking the old covenant and writing it to show you who Jesus is. In Hebrews chapter 10, he said, Jesus quoted from Psalms, in the volume of the book, it's written of me. Why did he take, why is it 39 books, 39 lashes? Why 27 in the new? Because it's when the ark rested in the second month on the 27th day. What? You have to know. You have to know. Why? Why do you have to know? Because people's lives depend on it. It's not about you. It never was. Before you were saved, it was. But since you have accepted Jesus, you realize they spent 3.5 years with the Word of God, the Old Covenant. The Old Covenant, the Word of God that was wrapped in a flesh man. 3.5 years, the Word of God was pouring in them, pouring in them, pouring in them. And he said, now go.
Yeah.
Do you sit with him? Do you meditate? Blessed is the man that walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stands in the path of the sin, nor sits in the seat of the scornful. But he delights himself in the Word of God, and in that Word doth he meditate day and night.
Hallelujah.
For he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water, which is the Word, which shall bring forth its fruit in its season. But the ungodly are not so. They won't stand or sit with the righteous. They're like the chaff, watch, driven by the wind. The word wind is ruach. 7307 in the Hebrew Strong. The spirit, you get around somebody, when you're on fire for Jesus Christ, because that's what you're supposed to be. That's why the fire set on top the ark. You are the ark. But what was inside of the ark? The Word of God. No word, no fire. You have to spend time with him. You have to. People's lives depend on it. I don't want to never ever, never not be able to give someone an answer to a question from the Word of God. I challenge people to do it. Challenge me, Facebook. Any question you have biblically, challenge me. I don't care what it is. I'm not saying I know everything, by no means, but I know my Jesus. And I've studied to show myself approved, not unto you, but unto God. But when you ask me that question and you get the answer, are you coming just for knowledge? Are you coming where your life can be changed and you could fall on your knees and worship him, the one true God, so that you too can follow him like me and others? A lot of people come in just for knowledge and they want answers, or they want to see if, you know, they could trip you up with something. And you know right in their heart where they're at. Knowledge, the Bible says, old covenant puffeth up. That's the old covenant, knowledge. In fact, Jesus told the Pharisees and Sadducees, you take away the key of knowledge and you don't enter in yourself. The key of knowledge is the first 39 books of your Bible. The knowledge to know what's right and wrong. Understanding is the new covenant. The manifestation. the shadow, Old Covenant, all the way to the very image of who He is. So you get knowledge. Then with it, you get understanding of who Jesus is. And the Spirit begins to connect the dots back to the Old Covenant. And now you begin to walk in wisdom. Knowledge with understanding produces wisdom. There's got to be three. There's other things about this, but I got to go on. The ark for Moses, Exodus chapter 2, verse 3 through 6. It was made with reeds as well. Now check this out. It was made with reeds, right? And it was pitched within and without. That's three. Pitched in, made with reeds, middle, on the inside, right? And they put Moses in it. What did Moses represent? The law. The law's in the ark. Where did they put the law of God? The Ten Commandments. Where did they put them? In the ark. Moses represented the law. Right? They in the ark. Here it is. Watch. Moses represented the law. Right? That's all he represented. No mercy. No spirit. There were three things in this ark, right? The law, Aaron's rod that budded, and the golden pot that had manna. The mercy seat on top. Moses, his name, they put him on the water, and because she drew him out of the waters of death, that's where, why was Moses in the ark? Because they killed all the firstborn, throwing them in a river. The waters of death. Check this out. Divine revelation. Oh, look how beautiful the baby is. And they reached in the ark and pulled out the law. It's not going to be good for Pharaoh's house. And they took the baby, Moses. Oh, look, Pharaoh's daughter. Oh, look how beautiful. Yeah. It's very beautiful. But you're handling the law with no mercy, no grace. Wow. You know that happened with the other ark as well. For when the ark came riding into Beth Shemesh after it left, Hophni and Phinehas, when it went to war, and Eli fell backwards and broke his neck and died because it was ungodly, Hophni and Phinehas took the ark into war, and it was captured by the Philistines and went into the camp, and the only thing that was inside of it was the law. So the five cities of the Philistines broke out with hemorrhoids and rats. They said, what are we going to do with this? They put it before their god, Dagon, the fish god. Yes. And when they put it in the temple by Dagon, when they came in there the next day, Dagon was on the ground face first. He was broke. But not all of him yet. His legs, his feet were broken off of him. They stood him back up. The next day they came in, his hands and head was gone.
That's right, amen.
He was just a stump. That'll show you who the God of gods is. And if you don't know who Dagon is, let me give you a little hint. It's Ariel's dad. Dagon was the fish god. I think he goes by the name of Triton with the pitchfork. They took that ark. Moses represented the law. Judgment came upon that house. You know, when the Lord returns, Jesus Christ returns, the dispensation of grace is over. He comes as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. His vesture is dipped in blood with a sword. It's judgment time. You need to know him heart to heart before you meet him face to face. And don't think, you know, well, this is what my pastor said. You better find out for yourself, because your life is in jeopardy. Your eternal life, where you're going to be eternally, is at stake. These arks. So, it was made with reeds pitched within and without. Here too we see that the ark means preservation. Moses was preserved. For Moses, he was preserved from the waters of death. All the other children died, but he was on top of the water. Hey, the ark floated on top of the waters. Huh? The ark, what it did? This ark, it floated on top of the waters. You know what's funny about this ark? In Genesis, and I'm going to give it to you. In Genesis 7, if you are hungry for more Jesus, man, whosoever will, let him come. Check this out. In Genesis chapter 7, verse 18, and the waters prevailed, this is with the ark, and the waters prevailed and were increased greatly upon the earth, and the ark went upon the waters. The ark went. That word went right there is the Hebrew word, like my brother said, it's the Hebrew word helek. In your Hebrew Strong's Concordance, it's number 1980, and it literally, the first meaning of the word helek, says the ark walked on top of the water. Wow. Remember? I think there was another ark that walked on the water. I think Jesus said, I only do what I see my Father do. Do you think he was waxing poetic?
No.
God the Father, the old covenant, had the 12 tribes of Israel and 70 elders. Jesus said, I only do what I see my Father do. He chose 12 disciples, Luke 10, and 70 other. But is that by coincidence? Do you know that Elisha, whose name means Yeshua, Jesus, plowed the field with 12 yoke of oxen? Jesus plowed our field with 12 disciples. Elisha's name means Jesus. Jesus' real name is Yeshua, which means salvation. This is called the Ark of Salvation. Makes sense? You can't stop at the altar and the laver, repentance and baptism, and think you have the right now. You have to come in and learn of him and be fruitful and multiply. Because if you don't, you will be cut down and thrown into the fire. And I'm sorry if you believe once saved, always saved. It is nowhere in the Word. I challenge anybody. Because if you believe something in the new covenant that doesn't line up with the old covenant, it's error. Because the old covenant is a shadow of the new, and the new is the old. And I think Jesus said numerous times, even in Revelations, Jesus himself said, if you don't repent, I'll remove your candlestick. If you don't repent, I will blot you out of the Lamb's Book of Life. And just so you know, the letters were sent to 7 churches.
Yeah.
I won't argue with you, but I'll show you the facts. And the fact is, you need to know your Word. Because not only does your life depend on it, but you've been commissioned to bring forth fruit into the kingdom. Do you think When God said, "Be ye holy, for I am holy," 1 Peter 1:16, that was just our righteousness is in Jesus Christ. Do we sin? Yes. But we don't walk after the flesh, Romans 7. We walk after the Spirit. Therefore, we're forgiven. We don't do things purposely. We don't live in fornication and adultery and drunkenness and a liar and stealing. Those things separate you from God. I don't care what aisle you walk down.
Yes.
And if the preacher says you're saved, he's a liar and the truth is not in him.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Yes, sir.
Find you a church that preaches the Word of God.
Yes.
By the power of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Because the Word of God has to fit together like a puzzle. It says one thing. In fact, when Jesus came, where the law dealt with the outer man, Jesus enhanced it in Matthew 5 and said, "Now, if you even look at a woman with lust in your heart, you've committed adultery." He tests the heart of men. The law dealt with the flesh. The new covenant, Jesus Christ, deals with the spirit. The law was written on the outside. That's why they ate a certain thing, ate certain foods, dressed a certain way. God was distinguishing his people by what was on the outside because the law dealt with the outer man. And he said the law could never change a man from the outside in. Therefore, the Holy Spirit has to come inside of you, change your heart of stone to a heart of flesh, and change you from the inside out.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
It's the only way. And he said, "Be ye holy, for I am holy." That's what Peter said. And that word right there, you know what it means? Let me give it to you in the Greek. It means practice righteousness. The Bible says that the priests in the Old Covenant wore the holy mitre, which said holy and separated unto God. We are kings and priests in the house of God. And Peter said it from the same book. "Be ye holy, for I am holy, says the Lord." We are priests. Don't break your plow. How do you break your plow? You start plowing into somebody's life, telling them about Jesus, and the next thing you do, you're down on the corner drinking and smoking marijuana and doing all kind of, and not being faithful to your wife and doing all of these crazy things.
Yes.
Do you know what's going to happen when you die?
Yes.
Listen, let me tell you. You're in trouble.
Yeah.
I judge no man. But I tell you this, I don't want to stand in your shoes when you stand before Jesus Christ. That altar and that laver is bronze for a reason. Do you know why? We'll go to Revelation chapter 1 when John looks at Jesus and sees his feet as burned in a fire that looked like brass. It was made with reeds, pitched within and without. Here too we see that the ark means preservation. For Moses, he was saved from the waters of death. It is interesting to note that the Hebrew word teba, T-E-B-A, Strong's number 8392, is used in reference to both Noah's ark and Moses' ark, and it literally means the word box or chest. It was a box. Didn't look like this. It was just a box. Okay? About 500 foot long, 515 foot long, 90 foot wide, 55 foot high. We also see another picture here when the children of Israel passed through the sea. Watch this with Moses. Moses, the children of Israel are passing through the sea. We also can see another picture here when the children of Israel pass through the sea in Exodus chapter 14. The waters become as a wall on either side as they pass through the sea, but judgment falls on Pharaoh. They were protected. And I think it says something like the rock that followed them, 1 Corinthians chapter 10, that rock was Jesus Christ. The ark was with them, and they walked through the waters. Salvation. But guess what? When the ark got on the other side, all right, Moses, who represents the law, raise up your rod. Boom. The third ark we see in the Word is the Ark of the Covenant. The Ark of the Covenant. This box. It says, an altogether different Hebrew word is used here. This word used here is the word around, A-R-O-W-N. This word also means chest or ark. That's what it is. But it also carries another meaning. In Genesis chapter 50, verse 26, this same word, around, for the ark, also speaks of the coffin of Joseph. Wow. You know why? Because they made the coffin in Egypt and Joseph's body was preserved. Preservation in the ark. Right. This is how I got started 17 years ago. That's why this pulpit is a coffin. Amazing. It refers to a coffin or a mummy case of Joseph. And also in 2 Kings, we find the same word used in reference to a money chest, where you put your money, you preserve your money in a big money chest. Preservation. The Ark of the Covenant, made of shittim wood, same as here, as Noah's Ark, overlaid with gold inside and out, right? Wood in the middle, gold inside and out. Wood, pitch within and without. Reeds, made of reeds, pitch within and without. Same pattern. This pattern is pointing to something. It was overlaid with gold inside and out. And also, we see three there, right? Three levels. Three. We see the preservation of the Ten Commandments and the Ark of the Covenant. We see the preservation of Aaron's rod that budded. And we see the preservation of the golden pot that had manna. God told the children of Israel to put all three inside of here to preserve them. Why? The ark represents the law. The manna represents Jesus Christ and his blood. An Aaron's rod made of an almond stick that was dead, came back to life, brought forth an almond blossom and the fruit, the Holy Spirit. God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit in one. If you think you're going to see three, they're actually one, but they have the ability to separate themselves. That's another teaching. Just like you're made up of spirit, soul, and body. We see preservation. Watch this. This ark. Joshua is going to carry the Ark of the Covenant into the Promised Land. Joshua, whose name means Jesus, after in the wilderness of 40 years, is going to cross over into the Promised Land, which is a picture of Jesus Christ crossing us over after 40 Jubilees. If you don't know what that is, come ask me. And Joshua, whose name means Jesus, the children of Israel cross over to the other side because Moses can only show you what's on the other side. The law can only show you what's on the other side. It can't show you, it can't take you over there. Moses wanted to see the glory of God, the face of him. And God said, no, but get in the rock. Huh? The rock. And he can only see the hinder parts. The law can only show you the back end, the shadow. Can't show you the face of God. Jesus Christ, he can. In fact, he can take you all the way to the Father. Because that's what he's called to do. He's called. When we come to Him, He says, no one could come to the Father except through me. That's His job, to bring us to the Father so we could see Him face to face. We see preservation. As soon as the priest stepped into the Jordan, it rolled back all the way to the city of Adam. The ark steps in the Jordan. The waters parted. The water gate opens, right? All the way to the city of Adam. And the children of Israel cross over from the waters of the Jordan. We see the preservation of the children of Israel as they carried it into war and the enemies were defeated. When they carried the ark, the presence of God, they were preserved in battle. David said, though 1,000 fall at my right and 10,000 at my left, nothing shall befall me. Can you imagine going to war with about 600,000 men? No guns, butchering swords, hatchets. Running into just a big, can you imagine? You fighting here, the guy stab you in the back. David said, I saw 1,000 fall at my left and 10,000 at my right. Because I was carrying the presence of God, nothing befell me. The word is quick and powerful.
Amen.
That's it. Your testimony carries weight. But it don't carry weight like the word. No word, I tell you again, no power. Amen. You got to be able to tell people and show people Jesus Christ. Now, that's the arks in the Old Covenant, New Covenant. You know, when this ark stepped into the Jordan, they put an altar of 12 stones under it in the middle of the Jordan. Well, that brings us to the New Covenant. Jesus. Jesus. The Greek name for Yeshua. His very name. Call upon the name of Jesus and thou shalt be saved. His name is Yeshua, which means salvation. His name is Jesus. When you calling upon that name, you're asking Him to be your salvation. This very place where they built this altar of 12 stones, this is a picture of Jesus Christ. This is a picture of Jesus Christ. This is a picture of, watch, this is a picture of Jesus Christ, the rest that we get with Him. The rest, Noah's rest, eight was saved. This is a picture of Jesus Christ when He returns. Judgment, the law. This is a picture of Jesus Christ. Now, God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit in one earthen vessel. One earthen vessel. That earthen vessel that crossed the Jordan and was standing there. They built an altar of 12 stones there. 1,500 years before Jesus came. Joshua built an altar of 12 stones 1,500 years before Jesus came. An altar prepared in the Jordan for not a ark, for the ark. And that ark was Jesus Christ.
That's right.
Who came to John, stood on an altar of 12 stones.
That's right.
And was professing, I am the fullness of the Godhead bodily.
Woo!
I am your preservation. Standing in an altar, on an altar. All in water, a laver.
Yes.
We see the Bible says that God, that Jesus Christ possessed the fullness of the Godhead,
Amen.
The Word made flesh, the Holy Spirit,
yes.
without measure, in one man.
Amen.
He was the ark. He was the carrier of God's presence. Do you know why the Pharisees and Sadducees didn't fool with him? They said stuff like this in John 6. How does this man know the law, not having been learned? That's right, because he wrote it. He was the Word made flesh. They asked him questions. He so blew their minds away, they dared not ask him anything anymore. This was the lawyers. You know what the lawyers were when you're reading your King James Bible? The lawyers were the Mosaic teachers, scribes, experts in the law. He said, you search the scriptures, and in them you think you have life. But big boy, they're all about me. He is the ark. If you know anything about the ark, we see in Noah's ark the Spirit coming in, the Holy Spirit, with an olive branch.
Yeah.
Jesus Christ in the water. Jesus said, I only do what I see my Father do. The ark walked on the water. Jesus walked on the water.
Amen.
The Spirit came in with the olive branch, the dove. The Spirit came down and descended upon Jesus, the olive branch, the olive tree.
Yeah.
He's the ark of our salvation. He's our preservation.
Yes, he is.
When the house of God was set up in order, it's all about Christ. The Bible says that in Genesis 40, when Moses had the house in order, fire descended down and sat on top of the mercy seat. And God said, I will speak to you there. Why? Fire descended, and I'll speak to you there. Fire, the word of God, Jeremiah, is fire. Hebrews 11, our God is consuming fire. Fire is the word.
Yes.
No word, no fire.
Yes.
Jesus Christ was the carrier in the new covenant. Here's the ark. I'm showing you the pattern. Here's the ark. Jesus Christ. In him was he was the Word made flesh. Received the Spirit without measure. Right? Jesus Christ, the carrier of the fullness of the Godhead. Jesus Christ, the ark. The ark standing. What was it? Hey, brother, you can see this? This is only 6 stones. If I could spread out to the other one. Jesus, the ark, standing on the stones in the Jordan. The children of Israel's in the wilderness 40 years. Jesus went into the wilderness after that 40 days. Another teaching. The ark of the covenant. That ark represented an old covenant.
Yes.
Jesus Christ is the ark of our new covenant.
Yeah.
Man.
The ark of the covenant was a throne for the Most High God, and his name is Jesus. In fact, the Bible shows us that Christ is our ark. Pattern. Follow the pattern. And let me tell you another thing. After being set free by the blood, the rock that did follow them in the wilderness, because of disobedience, The Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, read it yourself, they ate the same spiritual meat, drank from the same spiritual rock, and that rock was Jesus Christ. And because of their murmuring and complaining and unfaithfulness, God laid them waste in the wilderness. They didn't get to cross over. It's called the church in the wilderness. The church is in the wilderness again. And if you think, in fact, Paul says around verse 9, 10, 11, talking to a church, brethren, this is for our example, so we don't do and lust after the things that they did. In fact, the Bible says that Christ is our ark of the new covenant, where we find our preservation for what's coming. Do you know that the ark of the covenant is mentioned about 185 times? And the last place the ark of the covenant is mentioned is in Revelations chapter 11, verse 19. In fact, that ark is Jesus Christ in Revelations 11:19, sitting on his throne. Wow. The Bible says in Revelations 11, verse 19, and the temple of God was opened in heaven. Hey, you don't think you need to know this? You don't think you need to know about the tabernacle and the temple and all of these patterns? There's a temple in heaven. Yes. In fact, when Jesus comes back, he's coming to rule and reign in his temple for 1,000 years. And you're going to be priest in it, out of the line of the tribe of Judah. Do you know what the priest did in the other temple? The Levitical house, the Levitical temple. Yes. We're priests. We're going to be working in the temple as priests to the Most High God for 1,000 years, Ezekiel 40 through chapter 47. Read it for yourself. Yes. I can't wait. Wow. Can you imagine to be sitting in the presence? And now, I ain't even going to touch Joe's sermon, because when the woman came from to see Solomon, who was that, Joe? Who was the woman that come to see?
Sheba.
Right. When Sheba come to see Solomon, and she came into the throne room, and she began to hear him. Man, I'm going to let Joe tell you that story. Man, it's a picture of Christ. Do you know the Ark of the Covenant is mentioned approximately 185 times? In Revelation 11, 19, and the temple of God was open in heaven, and there was seen in his temple the ark of his testament. That's Jesus. And there was lightnings and voices and thunders and a great earthquake. The ark was called, watch, that ark was called, but is also, this is a picture of Jesus Christ. And I'm going to tie it in, it's just about finished. It's called the ark of the testimony. Don't you stand up and give a testimony?
Yes.
Ooh, are you an ark?
Yep.
Watch. It's called the Ark of Testimony, the Ark of the Covenant, the Ark of the Lord. Oh, let me give you the scriptures. It's the Ark of Testimony, Exodus 25, 22. The Ark of the Covenant, Numbers chapter 1, 10, verse 33. The Ark of the Lord, 1 Kings chapter 2, verse 26. The Ark of God, 1 Samuel chapter 3, verse 3. The Holy Ark, 2 Chronicles chapter 35, verse 3. The Ark of His Strength, Psalms 132, verse 8. The Ark of the God of Israel, 1 Samuel chapter 5, verse 7. The Ark of Shittim Wood, which is humanity. The Ark of the Lord. Exodus chapter 25, verse 10. This is the only piece of furniture. This is the only piece of furniture that inhabited four different sanctuaries. This piece of furniture, because it inhabited actually five. This is a picture of Jesus Christ. This was, the ark was in the tabernacle of Moses. Then it was in the tabernacle of David. Then it was in Solomon's temple. And then it disappeared. And then it came out from behind the veil, clothed in Jesus Christ. He was the ark. Herod's temple, they're doing sacrifices. And he is the ark. He's veiled. The ark was behind a veil. Jesus Christ, the ark was veiled, and they didn't even realize it. The ark in a man. The ark in a man. Tabernacle of Moses, David, Temple of Solomon, and the fourth place. The Bible says that you are the temple of the Holy God. You are a temple of the Holy Spirit. Don't you know that, number one, God don't want the law written in stone, but in your heart. Amen. That's the law. Yes. In fact, he goes on to say, you know the golden pot that had manna? The Bible says, which is Christ. I think it says, Christ in you is the hope of glory. That's two. And when the Holy Spirit comes, he's going to come and make his abode inside of you. You are now the ark of God's covenant. You are supposed to be an ark of the Lord, an ark of testimony, an ark that carries around a new covenant, offering it to people. The Bible says that we're made from the dust of the earth. We are earthen vessels. And I think in 1 John chapter 5, the Bible says, and I hope you have all three. There are three that bear witness in heaven, and there are three that bear witness in earth. Listen to me. It don't say on the earth. It says in an earthen vessel. The Spirit, the water, the Word, and the blood of the new covenant. And these three agree as one. You have to have the Word of God in you, the key of knowledge. You have to have the golden pot that had manna, the flesh and blood, Jesus Christ. You have to have him. And you have to have the Holy Spirit. Because without it, you don't have a witness. And the last, it says, that the Spirit bears witness, your spirit, with the Holy Spirit, that you are the sons of God. Because let me tell you something. Let me explain something to you. Because there's a lot of different arcs out there. Listen to me. Watch this. God, you're awesome. If they just have the law in them, well, you'll know when you run across one of those cats. When they don't have the Spirit of grace and mercy with the golden pot that has manna. Because when the law is just in the ark, when you think you know and you have knowledge, knowledge puffeth up, it's prideful. You need to know it though. You think when Jesus said, be as wise as a serpent, What is that? Where was the serpent in the tree of the knowledge of good and evil? What is the tree of the knowledge of good and evil? The old covenant. God himself says for you and me, Jesus himself says, be as wise as a serpent, but as harmless as new covenant, a dove. When you run across a person that just rips you up and says things to you, you see him on a street corner, you're going to hell. They don't have no spirit. They are ark carrying the law, working for Satan himself. Because the Bible says that Satan is an accuser of the brethren. And Jesus didn't come to condemn the world, but to seek and to save that which is lost. Amen. And how can I tell someone that they're going to hell? When Michael the archangel, when disputing with Lucifer himself, this is in Jude, the 65th book of the Bible, dared not, an archangel dared not to even bring a railing accusation against Lucifer. Because when you accuse somebody of something, your father is the devil. But said to Lucifer when disputing over the bones of Moses, Lucifer, and I guarantee it, Michael the archangel, boy, he could have poured it on Lucifer, you no good, dirty, rotten, hypocrite, and dog, you. He didn't say it. He said, Yeshua rebuke thee, the Lord. And I said Yeshua, because King James changed the word right there and put Lord, and Lord means landowner in Britain. And I hope he is your landowner. But the name is Yahweh. He said the name of God, the Lord rebuke you. How much more? So if you just have the law, the Bible says knowledge. And I'm going to show it to you with one last scripture. If you got people just cutting you up, because the sword is two-edged. One way it brings death, it's two-edged. Why is the sword double-edged? If you only got one edge, you're in trouble. One way it brings death. 3,000 died at Mount Sinai. Law given. The very same day, Pentecost, that's when Moses received the law. On Pentecost, God came down. Holy Spirit came down on the day of Pentecost. On that day, 1,500 years later, on that same exact day, Peter gets up, uses the old covenant. Men and brethren, don't think that these men are drunk as ye suppose in Acts chapter 2. But these are not drunk as ye suppose, seeing it's 9 o'clock. Watch what he does. He uses the sword. Watch. But this is what was spoken of by the prophet Joel. Old covenant. But he uses it now. Under the Holy Spirit and the new covenant under the blood, and didn't call them dogs and sinners, but he called them to life. He said this is what was used in the old covenant. You know where Moses, at the giving of the law, they knew what time it was. They knew this is when God came down. 3,000 died. I think Peter stood up on the very same day, 1,500 years later, with the edge on the other sword, other side, and swung it, and 3,000 were saved. The sword's got to be two-edged. The word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than a two-edged sword. Listen to me. If you have just law in you, that's death. If you just have the new covenant, that's greasy grace. That's the doctrine of the Nicolaitans, which God said, I hate. Yep. But when you got the old covenant, God the Father, you cannot remove the law. You take a daddy out of a house, you get chaos. Paul said it was our school teacher. Paul said it was our school teacher. Listen to me. Go to school.
Yeah.
Learn your word. Study to show yourself approved. And watch what happens. When you get old covenant, the word in you, and the new covenant, now you got knowledge with understanding, which makes you walk in wisdom. Oh, let me show you. So I show you it's biblical. I'm going to read it to you. Proverbs 2. Look what he says. My son, forget not my law, but let thine heart keep my commandments. Jesus said, my commandments are not burdensome. Right? For length of days and long life and peace shall they add to thee. Let not mercy and truth forsake thee. I'm done, people. Love people. Show mercy. Bind them about your neck. Write them upon the tables of your heart. Proverbs chapter 2. Read it. Watch. So shalt thou find favor and good understanding in the sight of God. Of God. And with men. Do you know when you love people, despite what they do, people are drawn to that? If you're not portraying Jesus, they don't see Jesus in you. Something's wrong. You don't have the word in you. Trust in the Lord with all of your heart and lean not to your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him and he'll direct your paths. Be not wise like the Pharisees in thine own eyes. Fear the Lord and depart from evil. It shall be health to thy navel and marrow to thy bones. Honor the Lord with the first fruits, honor the Lord with thy substance, and with the first fruits of all thine increase. So shall thy barns be filled with plenty, and thy, oh my Lord, Father, wow. I'm reading chapter 3. That's amazing. Let me go back. I'm sorry. It's chapter 2. I thought I was reading 2. That was the Lord, though. Watch this. My son, if thou will receive my words and hide my commandments in your heart, so that you incline your ear unto wisdom, watch, and apply thy heart to understanding, watch. Yea, if thou criest after knowledge, and incline your ear to understanding, you'll walk in wisdom.
Yeah.
It's his word. If thou seekest her, the word of God, watch. If you seek her as silver is redemption in the Bible. Silver is redemption. And search for her as for hidden treasures. Remember the money chest? Wow. Then thou shalt understand the fear of the Lord and find the knowledge of God. For the Lord giveth wisdom, out of his mouth comes, watch, and I close, out of his mouth comes old covenant knowledge and understanding new covenant. This is what it says. So you can walk in wisdom, the full counsel of the Word of God. And I'm going to say it again. The riches of redemption, no matter how you cut it, it bleeds Jesus. You can cut it just into the Torah. You can cut it into the which is the first five books of Moses. You can cut it into Moses, Psalms, and the prophets. You can cut it into the Old Covenant and the New Covenant. But the fact of the matter is, it bleeds Jesus. Do you want to know him? Man, he loves you. Man, just seek him. The Bible says when you seek him with your whole heart, you'll find him. He loves you. If I can help you in any kind of way, shape, or form, my number is 601-347-4109. I don't have money, silver and gold. Silver and gold have I none. And when I tell you that I walk by faith every day, I walk by faith. I walk by faith. This church pays me a small salary, gives me a housing allowance about $400 a week. But I'm gonna tell you something. This body, a month. I'm sorry, $400 a month. But let me tell you something about this body. They are amazing. The people that are here are absolutely amazing. They know what I go through and the struggles that I have. And let me tell you something, my work. These guys will do anything they can to help, and that's what we're called to do.
Amen.
But I'm giving you my phone number, and I'm telling you, I don't have silver and gold, but I have the riches of heaven.
Amen.
And if you want to know more about Jesus, you can call me at 601-347-4109. And if you want to know something about the Lord, man, call me anytime. I love you guys. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Amen.